So it is Tuesday, the 31st of May, 2022, and this is episode 24. Can you believe it? Episode 24 of All Back to Mine. And this is a special show in a way. We've got Kut Class, who's my special guest, who I'll bring on in a minute. But we're going to be getting quite nerdy, I think. We're going to be talking about scratching. We're going to be talking about sampling. We're going to be talking about beats. We're going to be talking about his label. It's going to be quite an interesting show, and hopefully lots of information, education, inspiration, that sort of stuff. If you're watching this back on YouTube, hit that subscribe button. It's free, helps the channel. If you're listening on Mixcloud, hit that follow button. And if you're watching on Twitch, then again, hit that follow button. And if you are watching on Twitch, then join us and talk and give us questions and throw anything at us, and we'll go from there. So without further ado, we...
Okay.
Yeah, I can hear you okay. I understand you're sort of home alone. We've had Constance on the show before, but she's away at the moment, so it's just me and you. So we're gonna get proper nerdy already. Oh no, here she is.
Oh, she's
in the chat. Hey, Greece. Ears must have been burning, but there she is. There she is. We've been, we've already said hello to Caesar, and Zia's met Caesar for the second time. So that's been fun. But yeah, I mean, you're a fan of the show, you know, which is always a bonus. And you've commented in the past about how you quite like listening to the origin stories of all the DJs, because obviously I take people back to the beginning. Oh, you're frozen. Are we? Are we frozen? Looks like we're still moving on.
Can you hear me?
Hello, we're still moving. I don't know.
Can you hear it like okay?
Yeah, I think so. Boom. Oh, anyway, it looks like we're live. It says we're live. It looks on my Twitch screen that we're live. I'm moving around. I'm sort of shaking my arms about, so it looks like that. Maybe it's the internet
as well.
Maybe the internet in Greece. But anyway, let's go back to the beginning. So origin stories. So when did you first get into music in terms of musical influences? You know, was it family, friends? Who was it?
Yeah, nice one. Firstly, big up everyone that's tuned in this evening, and thanks for listening. Yeah, you're right. I do listen to like a lot of these shows, and I always find it's funny because, like, you know, like I'm a fan of the Marvel stuff, and they always do like the origin story. Like you see, you know, like the character, and then they do the flashback and the origin story, and I keep going laughing, being like, oh, you know, like we see all these people that are DJing at the weekends or like whatever through Twitch, and finally, like you get to hear like their origin story through All Back to Mine. So yeah, it's been really, really cool listening to that. So yeah, I thought for my 7/7s, All Back to Mine, what I would do is pull out some 7s that would be like a soundtrack to my origin story, or like the soundtrack to sort of some stories about myself, and sort of like link it all in that way. So yeah, sort of going back on my early influences, I was born in the 80s. And that meant I was born into the era of awesome fluorescentness and breaking. And when I was a little kid, we had a Betamax. We didn't have a VHS. So if anyone remembers the struggles of having a Betamax to try and get hold of videos, that was like absolutely impossible.
Well, Betamax was actually meant to be the better quality one, wasn't it? It was just for some reason VHS, more people jumped onto VHS, and that's why it lasted, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, I think you could play the videos longer as well when it was higher quality.
Yeah.
But yeah, we had this top loader, and basically the only sort of videos you had was stuff you recorded off TV.
Yeah.
And I had a copy of Breakdance the movie when I was a little kid.
Right.
And out of the small selection of videos that we had, Breakdance the movie was the one that I used to play nonstop and get down. And when we used to go out to do like family things or whatever, I was like the little performer. My brother would be like, hey, Adam, you're going to break. And I would get like probably like crawl around the floor like a monkey, you know, like something crazy. but like back in the day, that's what I thought I was doing. I was breaking, and I love that kind of stuff. And that was like my introduction to hip hop when I was like a little kid, really. And
so, I mean, can you remember, like, I mean, that's obviously the breakdance. I mean, can you remember the music that was sort of accompanying those videos?
Yeah, I mean, that would have been like early electro stuff. Like, I think it's like, funny enough, they did a re-release of Breakdance, the movie soundtrack, for Record Store Day. And I saw that's crazy expensive.
Right. Yeah, as everything is.
Yeah, but that's actually like a dollar bin thing. You can find that anywhere on the cheap. So don't buy the RSD one. But yeah, like that was like, yeah, electro, I guess. Like Manfresh, like the Beatbox, Tour de France. Yeah, kind of electro-y stuff more than hip-hop. And then I guess sort of more hip-hop stuff that I would have been exposed to. This is mostly coming through my older brother. So I've got a brother, he's 5 years older than me, so he's a little bit older. And so where I'd have been a little kid, I'd have been probably listening to all the stuff that he would have been listening to.
Right.
So like, and then I guess like, there was like the influence of my parents as well. Like but like a musical-ish family, which is not funny. My parents aren't musical at all. They're not at all, but my grandfather was. There's a poster that's up on the wall here, which, funny enough, I found on eBay. We're rediscovering the history of my grandfather because he was an interesting man. He was involved in like the 1950s rock and roll scene in London. And he played a lot of famous rock and roll acts at the time.
Wow.
And there's like a crazy story where really him and my father weren't friendly for a little bit. He wasn't really talked about in the house. And so actually, funny enough, me and Constance, that's one of the things we've been doing is digging back through our family history using online and finding out a little bit about this chap. But yeah, my dad used to talk about him a little bit when I was a kid and the fact that, you know, he used to play guitar in a band. And that was kind of like this influence I always used to have as well in the back of my mind, which is Grandpa John, who I never met. Used to play a rock and roll band. And then my parents, you know, they were into sort of soul music from the late 60s. The Beatles fans, like anything. So we had music in our house, not a lot of music.
Right.
But those were kind of like my influences, was this idea of this rock and roller in my family, the music we had lying around. And then my brother that was bringing sort of like this hip hop influence into our lives, I guess. And so, like, yeah, he was, like, massively into the Beastie Boys. I always remember my mum screaming at him, like, can you turn the music down? and it's funny because DJ D, he played, like, the Beastie Boys parody, the No Sleep Till Bedtime, on her show, which was classic because, you know, I remember that. Yeah. I don't know if you remember, but there was, like I said, at the time there was a TV show, and, like, I had to check that because, like, I couldn't remember if I was, like, false memory or some weird shit.
Right.
But they did have a little run of a TV show. So all those little things, you know, those little things that I was sucking up all the way through, like childhood, was any kind of like hip hop was not a big thing, like, especially in the UK, like you grabbed any influence that you can and you could see. I grew up in Southwest London, but on the sort of outer edges of Greater London. And funny enough, sort of like music, that kind of music was like quite a big thing sort of where we lived anyway, like hip hop music.
Yeah.
Sort of later, like, you know, sort of when I was young still, sort of my 9 or 10 years old, sort of the rave scene that started coming along. Like I said, I had an older brother, so I was exposed, where he was 15 and going out to raves and bringing home the music, I was exposed to all of that. So, yeah, it's kind of like
amazing. This
melting pot of being in an era which can never be repeated and being in a place that can never be repeated in a situation
that exposes
to this stuff. And you look back and reminisce and say, oh, why can't it be like that? I'm sure it'd be kicking again, but it's just a time and a place thing, right?
Yeah.
Anyways, so this kind of links me to my first record because I wanted to talk a little bit about my influences. My mom passed away, but one thing I do have is some of her records, and I went through, it's funny, I dug these out the other day because they're really badly kept, actually. This is the first one I put in a sleeve, and I did it just for this. But we're going back through the records, and I was just like, oh my God, like, I remember all these songs being played when I was a little kid, and I just didn't realize that she had so many funky breaks in her collection. Like, there's this one that I'm going to play, which is The Clapping Song by Shirley Ellis.
Classic, yeah.
I think someone might have played this on one of their shows. I forget.
It's one that Zia's quite fond of. I've played it to her a few times, and then she's got a copy of the Bell Stars version, I think. But I've got a copy of this as well. But yeah, it's great. It's such a great track.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's a cool one. So yeah, let's put this on.
Okay, let's have a listen. If you're tuning in and would like to help, then hit that host button.
Oh, that'd be good. It's going to be very crackly.
With your left arm, pat your partner's left palm. Clap, pat, clap your hand, pat your partner's right palm. With your right palm again. Clap, slap, slap, slap your hand, slap your thigh, and sing a little song. Go. My mother told me if I was good in, that she would buy me a rubber dolly. My auntie told her I'd kiss the soul.
I might have a go at skipping forward through that and see if I can find the break quickly, if that's all right.
Yeah, go for it.
And clap. Clap. Partner's left. Palm with your right palm. Now back. Just slap your thighs and I'll take the pats. Clap. Now back with the clap. Take the pats of your palms and slap your thighs and watch the fun materialize as you sing this.
Maybe not this time, but yeah, there is a really funky bit breakdown breaking there.
If anyone hasn't done sampling or anything before, then obviously that's a sort of an experience of how you do it. You know, you sort of go through it. But interestingly, I was listening to reading. I don't know if you read it yet. The Jay Dilla book. I don't know if you've started reading that one up.
No.
I've started reading that, and obviously what he was saying that in that is that like a lot of people sample or try and find breaks like you do, you know, sort of moving the needle up and do that, whereas he would just let the records just go and he'd listen to whole entire albums or whole entire you know, singles, because then sometimes you can find something that you might miss, obviously, if you're sort of all skipping through. But yeah, it was just an interesting little point of a different way of sampling, you know, and different way of finding beats. But yeah, no, great choice. Really great choice. Great one to open the show in. And yeah, again, it's you know, like you say, it's good to have that link back to your mother, and obviously music being a part of it, you know, and the memories of remembering her playing it, you know, that's so important. And that's going to be with you forever, you know, and that's in your brain because of your music that you've got the connection. But yeah, so we're sort of at, I think you're about 10 by this stage, if your brother's 15. About this sort
yeah
of age.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, so yeah, we're about yeah, so yeah, around that age. Yeah, so we're, yeah, we're, my brother's playing like the Beastie Boys.
Yeah,
I'm listening to like music through my bedroom wall. Like I said, he used to crank it up. My mom used to scream, turn that shit down. And I used to just listen through the wall. And then what started happening was my brother started going to raves, and the music that came through my wall changed. And it was what he was into was hardcore and like old school. So okay. You know, like, sort of like the precursor of sort of jungle and things like that.
Yeah.
And kind of that crossover between sort of acid house and where it started going more into sort of like the breakbeat driven stuff. And yeah, he was, yeah, I was probably about 10, he was about 15, and the music changed and he started going to raves and started playing sort of the tapes, and started wanting to build a record collection. And what he would do is he would take me out record shopping with him. So okay. We had, where we live in Sutton, or, you know, I that's where I grew up and I still live there. And yeah, there's two places near near where I live that used to be good for record shopping. One was Kingston, and the other one is Croydon, and we're sort of on sort of 20 minutes in between the two of those. And Kingston used to be awesome because it had this place called Slamming Vinyl Records, which was like three floors, all different, like it was all electronic music across three different floors, and each floor kind of did a different genre. And he used to take me into Slamming Vinyl when I was like 10 years old, and he was like 15, and he'd like go up to the counter and be like, what's awesome that's in this week? And the guy, I'd say like, what are you into? And he'd say a few names, and then the guy would pull out, like 15, 20 sort of records, and then be like, right, go over to the listening booth. And what we'd do is we'd split the pile of records, and he'd give me 10, he'd have 10, and we'd listen to them and put our favorites to one side, and we'd switch them over and do the same again.
Amazing.
And kind of looking back on it, it was probably a way of extracting money out of me to boost his record collection.
Oh, were you having to pay for your...
I mean, I'd buy one or two, and he'd buy the bulk of them. Like, I'd chip in, and right, like, that was our records kind of thing.
Yeah, that's cool.
And so that's kind of like he kind of introduced me to like the world of like buying records. And again, I was 10 years old, so I wasn't going to be going up to the guy and being like, hey, can you pull me out some LTJ Bookham or whatever. But I kind of I picked up the vibe from that. It's funny because again, thinking about it, he also sort of did that with gambling with me as well, which is kind of a side story,
right?
But yeah, he used to love taking me to the casinos when I was a little bit older, but so you used to show me
that's a great bonding way. It's a little bit like when I go to Rare Kind with Zia, I'll be downstairs looking at the 45s, and then she goes upstairs with all the dance music and drum and bass and stuff, and then she'll listen to some stuff and then go, oh, I've got these three records I want to buy, they're 50 quid. I was like, you can have one.
Right. There's no how to do it. Push it on.
Well, exactly. I'm like, I've got to spend the money on my 45s first, and then if there's anything left, you can have a record. But it's that bond, and like you remembering it with your brother. I'm hoping in years to come, Zero will remember, that going to Rare Kind and going that. That's cool. We have got quite a lot of music to get through. So I don't know if we've quite got to the next.
Let's go to the next one. So look, this is kind of this is maybe a note to my brother, and it's kind of linked in. So
perfect.
This isn't a rave tune, but what this is, my mom used to drive us to school. Me and my brother had three tapes in the car. One was EPMD,
right?
One was Bismarcky Going Off, and the other one was Beastie Boys License to Ill. And we used to rap this tune in the car on the way to school.
Brilliant.
I got to tell about three bad brothers you know so well. It started way back in history with that rap and me.
My team.
Then had a little horsey named Paul Revere. Just me and my horsey and a quart of beer. Riding across the land, kicking up sand. Sheriff's watches on my tail cause I'm in demand. One lonely BCIP. All by myself without no bot key. The sun is beating down on my baseball hat. The air is getting hot, the beer is getting flat. Looking for a girl, I ran into a guy. His name is MCA, I said howdy, he said hi.
Like, I think everyone like had their raps when they were kids, and like, this is, I'm like a sucker for a story rap as well.
He told a little story that sounded well rehearsed. 4 days on the run and that he's dying of thirst. The brew is in my hand and he was on my tip. His voice was hoarse and throat was dry. He asked me for a sip. He said, can I get some? I said, you can't get none. Had a chance to run, I pulled out a shotgun. Quick on the draw, I thought I'd be dead. He put the gun to my head and this is what he said.
Alright, yeah. So you got the gist of it. I'm sure like everyone knows that tune is.
It's a classic. Yeah, I mean, Beastie Boys classic. Absolutely brilliant. Big up Double P. Evening. How you doing?
Hey,
great
up,
to see you. That's another great choice. So two great choices in it. And obviously almost like different ends of the spectrum, with the clapping song and then Beastie Boys. But obviously they fit in, and it's these little building blocks, isn't it, that take us through our musical journeys and our musical careers. And obviously we take something from everything we listen to, I think, definitely all the way through. Cool. Okay. So let's jump forward, probably a little bit, because do you then get into DJing?
So yeah, he kind of shows me the ropes. We buy some records, and we end up going halves on a set of decks. He probably those were in his room for a little bit, and then he got tired of me knocking on the door and sold them and gave me my money back. And then I saved up and I bought another shitty pair of belt drives, and those were mine and mine to use. And that's when I started DJing. And then I do like things like, I think like most people did, like house parties and stuff like that.
Yeah. Let's just pause there. Yeah. What age is that when you've got your first decks?
Oh, I got my first decks around 14, I guess. Yeah.
Okay. All right. And are you then doing house parties quite soon after that? Or was there a sort of...
Yeah, I would have probably been about 15. Like my mates, like my best friend was a school year older than me. Yeah. So when he would have done his GCSEs, like 16, like if there's a blowout party and I was DJing and that. Like at the same time, I kind of never mentioned, but I was quite musical at that point.
Right.
So like when I was young, I had piano lessons. When I went to secondary school, I started doing classical guitar. I must be about 15 or 16. I joined a band with some of my friends and we used to play I was playing bass guitar in the band and we used to play like Green Day covers and things like that. We used to write our own songs. And at that point, I got a bit of studio experience with those guys. We funded going to a studio and recording some stuff. I kind of had something else happen to me at that point, which was I used to go to a youth group and one of the local youth groups had opened a studio there and they were running a 10-week course on how to use the studio. So I did that as well and I got some studio experience that way. So I was kind of like being quite musical at the time with the band and having the decks and playing my mates' parties with the band and the decks. And doing this thing at the studio where I was trying to learn the studio equipment. I passed that course, but in the end, I was very intimidated to go back to the studio because it was just an intimidating place. I never went back. All of this again was sort of building my journey. And then went to university. I fell in with a drum and bass crew. Guys used to like DJ drum and bass, and at the time, again, from my rave background and the hip hop, and just growing up in sort of southwest London at the time, where like drum and bass was massive, and jungle was massive, and garage was massive, and everyone, you've seen what's it called? People just do nothing. That's a parody of like my teenage years. I knew like 10 MC Grinders when I was a little kid. But, it's really, really funny to watch and kind of painful, but funny. a lot of people just do nothing. I fed him with a drum bass crew at university and we were putting on nights. So shout outs to Jim Bain, who still does his thing up in Manchester. And then, my mate Gav as well, who let me get on, he became quite a big name in the drum and bass sort of scene. Everyone went on to go and do their things from that stuff that time at university. But I came back to London and I came back with a bump and some reality. And I just hit the grind 9 to 5. Student days behind me, no more DJing for me. But at that point, like hanging out with the drum and bass DJs, I'd learned a lot about production because all of them were learning to produce. And at the time I was like badly writing drum and bass, like very, very bad.
What were you using back then? Did you have your own little setup?
Oh, wow. I just had the computer and I was using Acid. Sony Acid. And at the time it was like audio only, and then it had like an upgrade where you could include VSTs because that was the realms of Cubase. I can get really nerdy about this. That was the realms of Cubase, and then I switched over to what was called Fruity Loops. That is now Fruity Studio, which is popular. And it was all about the free version, right? And you couldn't save, so basically you had to have a session that you left open the whole time, and then you bounced down at the end, and that was it. Finished tune, done.
I mean, Fruity Loops was a strange one, wasn't it? Because I think if you bought it, it was almost like a legacy update for a long time. I think for a period of time, you didn't actually have to buy it. I mean, obviously, going back, a lot of people didn't have legit copies. But I think, I think if you did buy it, I think it just sort of upgraded almost. I think they talked about lifetime updates. I don't know if it ever was, but it was
like note save was the whole thing. It was like you could do anything you liked in it. It was unlimited, but you couldn't save.
Yeah, yeah. But it's it had enough, but not too much. I think a lot of the we're talking about this with Don Champsan last week, because he just likes his hardware rather than sort of doors, DAWs. And you know, I think Fruity Loops had just about the right amount of stuff that it wasn't too much going on that you could get something together really quickly.
Oh yeah, yeah. Super fast workflow with like the step sequencer just right in front of you on limited steps.
All of that.
And like it did, and like it's still like. I know a lot of producers, or like not even like modern day producers, love it for like there's like a bass, like a max bass effect in it that's like supposed to be amazing.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's good that it's still sort of around. I've got no idea what it's maybe like 14 or 15 through. I don't know what number it's on now, something like that. But yeah. It's all
like,
a bit
mad popular in like the grime and drill scene.
I think it's like
I was like watching like How to Make Drill the other day, and the guy was using like Fruity Studio. So I was like, because really works well with like the steppy nature of the music as well, and doing those fills and rolls, you can just step them in.
Yeah, yeah, cool. Right, well let's have another record. What have you?
All right.
What's the next?
All right. So maybe I'm going to fast forward a little bit then. So the next record I pulled out, there's a story that goes behind this. So this is a dub plate. I don't know, I've been yapping quite a lot, but I fell in with the drum and bass guys. I started doing some scratchy stuff, and through the scratchy stuff, I ended up working on Cut and Paste Records label.
Yeah.
And I did a release with them, which was a scratch record.
It's my Cut and Paste bag.
Say what?
It's my Cut and Paste bag.
Oh yeah, shit. Yeah, you've got the Cut and Paste bag. So yeah, big up Criztoz, because that like. There was like five of those made. They were handmade, and I didn't actually get one because I was slept on it.
I love it. It's great. It's great. I'm glad I bought it. But yeah.
Yeah, that's really sick. If anyone's wondering why I'm pointing up there, it's because I've got a screen up here, and that's how I'm watching stuff. So the camera's here, the screen's up here. So in case I'm doing that to the screen, that's to you guys, even though the camera's there. But yeah, so I did like this 12-inch with Cut and Paste Records, and I started touring. Basically, I did this record, and what happened was I lost my job just after the record came out. And so I sat on the couch with a mate being like, oh man, like, you know, I'm buzzing my tits off because this record came out, but I just lost my job. It really sucks. I don't know what to do. And he's like, look, you got a small payout from work. Go and have like a holiday, go have the time of your life. And I was in the doldrums and I was like, you know what? That sounds like a brilliant idea. I'll go like to the, at the time we were hockey, like making connections all across the world, but a lot of connections in the US, which is like massively popular for scratching. And we were sending records to these jams and making very personal connections with how we were selling the records. And so my plan was basically to go across and meet everyone that had been buying records. And I planned this like 10, I think it's like eight or 10 stops, tour, east to west coast of the US, meeting people that are distributing our records. And so I was like, oh man, what, like while I'm away, I want to be scratching still. Like, you know, I'm going to meet with people that are scratching. Like I want to be able to keep sharp. And I also want to try and like take some footage. And at the time the portable stuff was just popping off. So I had, a little Vestax portable, and I had like one of the first, portable faders that came from Japan. I can't remember the name. It's like a tiny little fader, that was very unreliable.
It's not one of the Raiden ones, is it? Raiden.
It was before Raiden. It's named after a little after like a mint, because it was in a mint tin. Version. But then the Raiden came out just before my trip. Anyway, at that time there weren't really many scratchy 7-inch records, and especially those that were skip proof and compatible with a portable turntable. So I was like, man, I'm going to have a really shitty time walking around with this portable turntable and nothing really good to scratch on it. And so what I decided to do before I went away was to make this record, which is a dub play of the first record that we made, re-edited down and then cut down into 7 so that it would all work. And the ninja thing about this record was it's like the first record that's skip-proof that's done at 88, which means that the samples, you don't need an ultra pitch for it to sound awesome. And it will all loop on a 4/4 beat. So that was unique about it.
Let's pause there because there'll probably be some viewers or listeners who don't know what we're talking about. So obviously the, not standard, but the usual scratch record would just carry on and there'd be, you know, there'd just be repeated sort of beats, but skipless makes it a lot easier. So, I mean, do you want to explain, if anyone doesn't know, what skipless means?
Yeah. So like skipless records have a large band on the record of the sample that repeats itself over and over again in such a way that should the needle skip, it lands in the exact same place in the sample where it skipped from. So it sounds like the record never skipped. So,
that makes scratching obviously a lot more straightforward.
Yeah. So yeah. And that's a point, which is when you're first sort of starting out, you might not have the record control, which means the needle will jump around. So back in the day, what you used to have was just a sentence that went from start to finish, right? And you might be scratching like, oh yeah, in the middle of that sentence, and suddenly your needle jumps, and suddenly you're scratching like, you know, it sounds terrible, right?
Yeah.
And so when you've got a skipless, if that needle skips, and you're scratching, oh yeah, it will go, eh, and then it will still carry on going, oh yeah, because it's skipped into exactly the same part, you know, a place in the record that is the same sample. So that is the principle behind a skipless. If I play you this record, because it's not a piece of music, so let's use it to.
What's it? What they trying to get? Are you ready? Got it?
What? Get the fuck up,
yo! What's up?
Cadence with rhythm and flow. Fresh.
I literally just put it straight into a sample, then, like a sentence. But let's try that again.
Plain terror,
yeah.
I'm just 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 plain terror.
All right, so can you hear it? So it's just repeating over and over again.
Yeah.
Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna scratch like the sample, and I'm gonna lift the needle and drop it, and it'll carry on using exactly the same sample, just sort of demonstrating the skip proof. Why it's called a skip proof, I guess. So yeah, the needle, I can pick the needle up and down, move it all around, it can jump, and I'll always be scratching R. Or like what's also very handy is that the way these records are designed, I'm gonna pull out a 12-inch everything falls apart now.
Wrecking the studio.
Yeah, completely. I'll pull out the 12-inch just to demonstrate, because we use the front cover to demonstrate what we were doing when we were making this record. So this is quite a nice diagram of what you'd see if you stuck the tracks in a door.
Yeah.
But I don't know if you can see that. Mm-hmm. This represents maybe about, I don't know, like 16 bands on the record, something like that. So you've got like a good sort of like 5 mil of play to always land in this sound. As the record spins, it's going to go, the record spins like this way, right? That's going to go through here. That's going to play R. And then it's going to get here and it's going to say something like, oh yeah. And then it's going to get here and it's going to say something like funky fresh. So like the way how this is possible is by what I was kind of chatting about in the chat with Dom Champion Sound the other week, which is kind of a little bit of BPM math and science.
Yeah.
This is kind of what we nailed when we were doing this record, which is we kind of nailed the science behind it and how it all works. Like, I think a lot of people that used to make these records in the past, they knew that the magic number was 1.33 seconds. And that if you program sounds within a loop that's that time frame, it would always loop round and hit. And there's actually a bit of better math that you can use to make your skipless records that we figured out. And it's not that difficult. And I say we figured out, which is, you know, this was invented by DJ Swamp, and he's always got to get massive props and kudos whenever skipless is mentioned, because you know he invented this shit, and we're just like kind of like in a way idiots to reverse engineered it a little bit, because we didn't even understand it.
Right.
The guy. But
let me try to figure it out. How did this guy invent this stuff? So, if you think about a turntable, right? So we always talk about 45s, but actually the magic number for us that's a bit more interesting is 33 and a third.
Yeah.
And what is 33 and a third? Mm. It's 33 revolutions per minute, right? So if your turntable spins 33 and a third revolutions per minute. So if I was to tell you that you could put a beat on the record, imagine the beat placed on the record, and it span, you know, at 33 and a third, how many beats per minute would that be? But if it was 33 revolutions per minute, and I put one beat on, you know, the record, that'd be 33 and a third beats per minute, right? If there's just one beat there, right? So that would be just one beat going like, you go like boom, 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 right?
Yeah.
So what we want to do is exploit that, right? And know that 33 and third is a magic number. And what we want to do is four beats per bar, right? Because that's normal to us when we listen to music. So you do 33 and a third times four, and that takes you up to 133.33, which is what this record was done at. And so that way it's going like boom, 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 as the record revolves. And so that's what we're exploiting. So once you know that 133.33, if you place a beat every, you know, like quarter of a bar or four beats per bar, it's going to loop around perfectly because that's the nature of the BPM you just picked. And then we can stick, like, if you go into a door, you set it to 133.33, and you set it to 4/4 because that's a normal time signature for us. And you start programming your samples at the beginning of each bar. What you'll get at four bars is like a perfect loop that will go round in one circle. So I know a lot of like DMC guys use that for editing. If you watch like someone like Richie Rothstein, not to call him out, but it's just because he's a friend. I watch a lot of his videos because he's a friend. But you know, like back in some of his sets, you'll notice that he'll spin the record round to 12. When I say 12 o'clock, like, you know, I'm always referring to like the face of the record, right? So the top of your platter is always 12, and you move around like the turntable list. You're kind of talking in o'clocks and you're moving around the platter in o'clock. So
is that still 12 o'clock, even though obviously your needle isn't necessarily at 12 o'clock?
Yeah, you always ignore, like, that's the interesting thing, because that's a stickering debate rather than an o'clock.
The
o'clock is always at 12, like a clock face. That's always the case. But some people do move the marker to be like the 12 o'clock to be where the needle is. But that's really more for stickering, right? That's kind of, again, that's an interesting thing, right? Because if you sticker at 12 o'clock and then you use that record on someone else's turntable, not all turntable tone arms are the same length. And so that 12 o'clock position moves. Well, if you sticker at the needle is always at the needle, no matter which turntable you're on. So that's a better marker if you're DJing off wax. But a lot of the time, you'll notice the DMC guys that are using Serato, like, or DBS kind of stuff. They'll be using 12 o'clock. You'll see, like, a lot of them have the clear records with the lines underneath them. You can easily see how they're queuing up. A lot of them are editing using the skipless BPMs, like 100 or 133, like the popular ones. And then what you'll notice is, they might like push the record round to hit it back to 12 because they know that everything has been programmed using skipless BPM, so everything lines up with the 12 all the time. Yeah. Then what you hear them complain about then is sticker drift, because they notice that Serato isn't keeping up with the fact that they're always knowing that it should be on 12, and Serato's edging things back slightly. And so that's like a big complaint about Serato when you start getting into the nerdy world of when you know your sample should hit at 12. But there's some latency in the software that makes the sticker drift. So
proper nerdy. I'm going to pause. Yeah, I am going to pause you there just for a minute. I'd sort of got this out, and then I saw Slim Gets Rad put the comment in, because he put the comment that Chris Carnes has the same thing printed on vinyl, visual vinyl.
That's right.
I've got a 12, which is this thing here. And obviously you've got, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And obviously as you're doing it, and then you've got R Fresh in the middle. And then I think you've got a beat. No, sorry, it's a beat in the middle. And then you've got R Fresh in here. And obviously you can see as you're scratching it, what you can do. And yeah, it's a lot of fun. You know, it's
Yeah, that's funny because we know the guys that make those records. That's like Mega DJ. And we showed them this idea.
Okay, hold on. Let me get that on the big screen on them.
So this was, yeah, when we released this, yeah, I mean, like when we released this record, it's got 2015 on the back. So, you know, like there's a timestamp right there. But when we released this record, we did something kind of unique and there's a story behind it. So
I'm just plain terror.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I sure am. But we put literally how we did the record on the front cover. And if you understood what we were doing, like people, you know, some people understood that, right? But then we took it one step further, actually. We made these stickers as well, which is basically kind of...
Yeah, I remember those.
What you've got, like, on your Criztoz record over there. And what these were was, rather than putting it underneath... So, funny enough, the way this started was... Cymatic, who, you know, is part, you know, he's cut and paste records, man, like through and through. When we were chatting, what he showed me a scratch record, and it was a skipless record. And what he'd done is he'd used Tippex to write like where the fresh was on the sample. He'd left that bit blank and written fresh around the fresh sample on the record with Tippex,
right?
Like, as you call it in the States. And it was kind of like the visual vinyl idea that he'd literally written on a black piece of vinyl. And I was like, man, like, why did you ruin that piece of wax? Why didn't you just write the fresh on the inside label instead? Like, it would do exactly the same. I mean, it didn't look as cool.
Yeah.
And then we stopped that. And that's where, like, this design came from, was that conversation of, oh, like, how about we make some stickers where we write the words on the stickers? And so we started with an original, that was the original design. And when we put the words on, you can see the group, like the WAVs, they're tiny. You couldn't see the words at all, but the WAVs work really well. So that was size design. Was
really cool, yeah.
And then there's a video up on the Cut and Paste YouTube, if you go on there, where I made this video of how to sticker up the records so that this sticker would always line up with the samples. And we call this like the scratch map. So you can see, or like the sticker map. So you could see exactly where the samples fell, and this kind of all lines up with what you're hearing. And then that's we were talking to, you know, the guys that make that. We were chatting online, and we were talking about the complexities of making what they did with Criztoz, and we thought it was just a crazy complex project. But mega props to them because they pulled it off, because it's a lot of hard work to make what they make.
It's
a very cool idea.
It's all very technical and complicated, and like you say, maths, you know, it's fascinating, absolutely fascinating, because obviously, you know, I've seen that before, and obviously I've got some of these records, and you know, I've been doing a bit of scratching. I'm not an expert by any means at all, but obviously, you know, I've had a go at all these, and it's so clever, and it's a slightly different, but on this one, on Cadence with Rhythm and Flow, you've sort of used, or they used the sort of logos and artwork from the records, didn't they? That they sort of sampled.
That's right.
You got a bigger version.
Yeah, that's it. So that on. Oh shit! I don't have it. Let's see if I've got a better one. Okay, that one's been. So yeah, there's a demo. This one's been stickered up. Let's see if this one's cleaner. So this was the second record we released. So this was Just Stay Funky, and it was, you know, same kind of thing again. Slightly different BPMs this time. There you go. So that's what you're talking about.
Yeah, because you can see the you've just got the sort of things that they've sampled, haven't you? You've got little bits from labels from different records.
Yeah.
And stuff. Yeah. Which, again, it's very, very clever design. Very clever design.
Yeah. No, I mean, this is all stuff that came from me and Sai's record collection, which is hilarious. That's kind of how it started. Was we were sitting talking about samples, and we just started pulling out records, so that's where it came from.
We'll come back to sampling maybe next, but let's have some more music. Let's have another record.
All right, cool. All right, so let's skip forward. So we chatted about the cut and paste stuff. I guess what I wanted to play, so we're putting out the scratchy records. We were getting involved in the scratch scene. I mean, you know, we were heavily involved in the scratch scene. I'm a mega fucking scratch nerd. But one of the sort of real things that we loved when we were sort of, before I became involved and I was a mega fan, was the scratch music that people were putting out. And so that was one of the things which was like, you know, battles were all good, but what we were trying to do was give people tools that would inspire them to make music, not necessarily, you know, trying to shit out of each other for prizes. And so you kind of noticed that the cut and paste records start switching it up a bit, which is rather than being just full on samples that were battle based into like musical samples to give people an opportunity to make music. And then one of the offshoots of cut and paste was we started doing lathe cut records with our homies out in Belarus, who are nice people and are afraid of Russians. So they're very nice people. So that's an NMTP studio. They've come over to London. They're the baddest of bad boys and they're sick at making beats. And they also have a lathe that they made themselves, like they're like mega geniuses as well as being bad men.
Wow.
We started getting involved with those guys because they had the lathe. Well, not because they had lathe, because they're legendary in the scratch scene as well, and some things that they've contributed. And it just made sense and we were friendly. And we started making these lathe cut records to fund projects. So the first sort of records we put out were the Scratch Blast, lathe cut series. And that was to fund the first tour that we did, which was like a UK tour. And then one of the offshoots of that has become the Scratch Lords, and they've been doing tours. And so to fund that again, there's been the Lord Call series of records. So yeah, and basically all these records have revolved around sort of the musical offshoots of the weird turntablist niche world. Whether it's music that's been made by people from the scratch scene, or whether it's actual scratching music. So I wanted to play, while I'm talking about that, one of the things, if you want to go check out my Mixcloud, I might as well plug it. I just suddenly thought I'll plug it while I can.
Yeah, go for it.
If you want to check out my Mixcloud, one of the things that I was doing at the time was I was putting together mixes of scratch music and the scratch output from the scratch scene. I think that kind of goes from something like maybe like 2014 until 2017. There's four mixes out there. And it's like around, my opinion, the best stuff that was coming out that year. And that's what I was doing was, and it's called Scratch Diggers. So if you see that, I think it's like Scratch Diggers volumes like 1 to 4, and that's like 2014 to 2017 and the music I was feeling from the scratch scene and like scratchy stuff. Like that included DMC competitions and everything. Anyway. Back onto this. So this was a record that we put out on Lordcore, and it's by my man Joe Clockwork, who's an absolute legend, UK based. And on this record, he takes the very classic Super Duck Breaks record.
Yeah.
Which I don't know if people have heard of that. It's a very famous scratch record that was made by DJ Babu out of the Beat Junkies and Dilated Peoples. And he's taken that record, and it's a very famous scratch sentence and scratch scene, and he's made a whole song out of it. So it's really dope, in my opinion.
Here we go! 1, 2,
Dope. In case anyone doesn't know what a lathe cut is, you know, what is it compared to your standard vinyl?
Yeah, so I think it's basically it's a one-off cut record. So whereas like a standard vinyl, the way a record is made is you start off with a lathe cut, right? Which is you feed the sound into a lathe, and the lathe has a needle that cuts directly. I mean, back in the day, it would have been into vinyl, but these days it's plastic. Sound is a vibration that could be translated into electrical current. So when we feed electrical current into the machine, we can vibrate a needle. And the needle, when it vibrates, cuts into the plastic. And so, like, the reverse of that is us putting the record on the turntable and the needle vibrating in the way that the plastic's telling it to, which is when we take that electrical signal out and put it into a speaker, we hear what it's playing, right? So that's kind of how, a lathe works, is it's a one-off cut. And then when you make a record, what you do is you take those lathes, an original lathe cut, and you make a casting of it. And then you stick that in a machine and you stick a lump of plastic in between the mold, essentially, and you squish it. And that becomes, then you let it cool, and that becomes your record. So, like, records are stamped using cast.
Yeah,
it's
always stamped. And if anyone's watched videos, obviously, you sort of see, don't they, put a lump of vinyl and it just sort of presses it down. And then they sort of cut around the outside and make it sort of properly round shape, don't they? But what you're saying is obviously the thing that you would use to make pressing, the pressing for the vinyl, that's what you would use as a lathe cut, because you make sort of like dub plates effectively, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, lathes were originally designed to make the masters that from which the molds would have been made. They were like originally like transcription devices, so think of them as like giant dictaphones, which is kind of crazy. They were used in old recording studios to record like radio plays and things like that, so they could then syndicate them and send them out to like the troops. Like those were like some of like the big uses. Wow. early days. So like when you find and then you had like even home recording lathes for I guess the wealthy that wanted to like record like their piano concertos at home or whatever the hell rich people do at that time. But yeah, like when you start looking, you know, I was quite heavily involved in lathe culture at one point. We had it's all hush-hush, but like there was a lathe in circular, you know, we had a lathe for cut and paste. At one point we had an old Presto that sat around my place for about 2 years being a bit unloved and worked on occasionally. It's funny, I would have pulled one of those records out as well, but they're horribly noisy things, which is some of our early test presses, test cuts we did on that lathe. And then we got quite heavily involved with we were helping out Henry at Dub Studio in Bristol with one of his projects for a fundraiser. And we used to, like when we were making like the scratch records, like we were getting quite a lot of dub plates cut at the time, so lathe cuts done. One-offs, so that we could test stuff out, because sometimes what works in Serato doesn't necessarily translate to vinyl, and we're being quite meticulous about what we were putting out and wanting to test. And then also kind of cool rocking up with the dub plate and people going, what's that? And be like, oh, you're interested, maybe we should put that out. That's stuff about the lathe cuts, really. But yeah, actually, one of the stories I was going to say was I was pretty lucky to go to like the vinyl factory.
London.
There's two vinyl factories. So that's a funny story about that, because there's two vinyl factories. There's the shop in London, and there's the actual vinyl factory where they make the records. Right. And when we had when Cadence was made, the very first record that Cut and Paste put out, that wasn't my record. That was Size. They got the they're like, oh, you know, your order is it ready for collection? And they're being super cheapskates, right? Rather than getting it delivered, they're like, oh, we'll go and collect it. And right. So the way the plan to go collect these records was to collect them in two suitcases on public transport.
Right.
This is before I was involved in the record label. Thank fuck. Because I would have pointed out that it's madness what they were doing. But anyway, so Darcy, so there's three of us involved in the record label, myself, Cy and Darcy, but originally it was Cy and Darcy, and I kind of came along when the second record got made. Because really I needed an out, me and Cy needed an outlet for putting this record out, and Cut and Paste already existed at that point. But Darcy rocks up at the Vinyl Factory store in London with two suitcases, being like, right, I'm ready to pick up my records. And they're like, what the fuck are you talking about? And he's like, you know, like, where do you keep, like, the equipment and stuff? Like, how do you do this in central London? They're like, we're just like a store for, like, you know, for the actual Vinyl Factory. Like, the Vinyl Factory's in Enfield. So yeah, Darcy takes like a very expensive train out to Enfield with two suitcases and like looks at the records and is like, holy shit, there's no way I can fit like more than like 100 records in these suitcases. What have I done?
How many they ordered? About 500?
I think they had 300 at the time.
Right.
But I think somehow he struggled and managed to take 300 records home in two suitcases on and a backpack and all kinds of crazy shit. So that was a funny story, but you know, again, like our friend Leighton Harris, big up Leighton, because he's the one that made it all happen, was working at the Vinyl Factory, and that was our in to getting records pressed. And like the Cut and Paste records thing only came about because when they turned out and they were filling in the paperwork, the people were like, you've got to have like a company name for us to like keep your account. And,
right,
and they came up with Cut and Paste like on the spot. There wasn't that much thinking about it. So that's the
great name.
Story
got the great name. Yeah.
But I was very lucky that I got to go. So for when we made one of the 7 inches, I managed to line it up, which is we'd had one of the 12s cut, and I was going to go again, still cheap skating, which was me driving up to the Vinyl Factory in Enfield and picking up like 500 records and shoving them in the back of the, like, I think, what did I have at the time? Like a tiny little car. But
that's a lot of weight as well, isn't it? That's a lot of weight, 500 records.
Yeah, I mean, they come on a pallet, you know, but now they get them delivered, they come on a pallet, right, yeah. Stacked up, and it is a crazy amount. But the day I went to visit the Vinyl Factory, I managed to work it out that they were going to be cutting my 7 that day. So if you go back on like my Instagram and scroll all the way back to something like 2016, something like that, there's like some footage of me at the Vinyl Factory watching them squish plastic between molds. And
that must be something, isn't it, you know, when you see a record of yours getting, firstly that you get it, but then seeing it actually pressed, that must have been amazing.
Absolutely awesome. Really cool experience. Everyone was very nice. The guys that work down there are mad old school. They've been doing their job for like 50 years, like, yeah. As the guy said, it's like, you know, the lathe's trigger's broom, if anyone gets that reference. Yeah, they know those machines inside out, and I've got nothing like but respect, because it's like there's a huge like art behind all this, and it's sad in a way that the idea that it could become forgotten knowledge. And I think some of the guys that like did that job are starting to realize that they're old and they're going to peg it, and they need to actually start passing it down now, which is why some of the knowledge is starting to get a little bit unlocked again. But you know, it was their job, yeah. And it was their speciality, and the idea of giving up your trade secret. Where it was nuts, because how are you going to keep your job?
It's like a lot of industries now, isn't it, because you know, young people are not necessarily coming into these industries, and unless they come in and learn from the beginning, they're not going to have the knowledge, and you know, all these abilities to make all these things are just going to go out the window, aren't they? And then no one will be able to do it, or there'll be so few, and it'll be so expensive.
Yeah, I mean, like Leighton again, the guy that hooked us up there. I mean, you know, they used to he started doing his own run of records, and he was like basically pressing his own record as like experimenting with the equipment, so like he could learn how to use it. And at the end of it was he was getting free copies of his own scratch record as well, which was really sweet. So, yeah,
amazing, nice one.
Yeah,
right.
That's a cool way of pulsing down the launch. All right, cool.
Definitely. Let's have another record.
All right. So chatting about lathe cuts, and I've been chatting a lot about cut and paste, but those guys are dead to me now. Just kidding. But I don't work for cut and paste records anymore. We ended up going our separate ways. What was that? Got 2018 now. And it's really just musically, we were just doing completely different things, like individually. We are still friends. They are not dead to me. That was just a joke. Like, we hang out all the time. And we chat all the time, like literally every day. So that is like, that was a fun joke for everyone listening. But things were changing in my life. And musically, we were just in completely opposite directions, really. While I've been doing stuff with cut and paste, I've come into contact with like a lot of like beat makers and hip hop heads and stuff like, you know, that I was doing when I was making music a little bit. Sort of, if you listen to one of the releases we did on cut and paste, like the Crave David record, it's like verging on a techno record, right? And it was just something that the guys were really into, like, you know, like that they are into. If you listen to like the Scratch Lords sets now, it's like fucking hot, like, you know, it's a real punky, edgy kind of style what they're doing, which is like hardcore punk techno electro scratching, which is super interesting and mad, and they're all high level and the music's crazy. But I was listening to something completely different. I was like getting much more into the beat scene and like sort of stuff that was coming out of like the LA beat scene and stuff that, you know, kind of like the old MySpace beats kind of thing. And like listening to like, you know, producers like DBRC, like big influence, and like getting influenced by like bits you were hearing from like the Low End Theory parties out in LA. So that was kind of what I was interested in was beats. And like, through cut and paste, I met a lot of beat makers. And so when I was calling it time on cut and paste, I was like, you know, like I can't just like not be doing this kind of stuff. Like, you know, like this isn't the end, this is the beginning. And that's kind of where I started my own record label, Just Good Beats. And the idea behind that was, yeah, all like, I was just meeting people that were making beats that they kept on their computers, didn't really do stuff with, like they were like maybe showcasing and performing them, but not, or like throwing stuff up on a Bandcamp here and there maybe, but like, just I thought they could be getting more recognition. And I thought, like, nothing is like better than like having like your own music on wax, right? Because that's something real. Like, anyone can sign up to like, you know, like an online distribution or throw it up on a Bandcamp, but not everyone like gets to have their music like immortalized in wax. So that was the idea. So I set up Just Good Beats. So basically, I kept on hearing this song that I had the MP3 of by Love Jones, which is Crush Love and Rich Jones. I had the MP3 of it and I was just like, man, like I just want to put this on wax. And I floated it at cut and paste, but the guys weren't feeling it for whatever reasons, because we're musically different. And I was just like, I've got the freedom, I've got the time and energy, and I want to do this, and I'm going to put on. So I was friends with Crush Love at the time. We were homies from Chicago. I was traveling to Chicago a fair bit by that point, because I was seeing Constance. Crush Love was a friend of mine through Eric Apana, RTST, who is like my homie from Chicago, like my bro. And yeah, he kind of connected us and listened to the music. And this song just kept on coming on again and again. I was like, man, I couldn't put this out, but now I can. So anyway, that's what gave birth to Just Good Beats, was this song by Love Jones, which is Crush Love and Rich Jones. Make sure I get the right side because I didn't mark these up. And this song is kind of basically what inspired me to do Just Good Beats and start my own record label. So
they might not. This could be so effortless, no plans or plots. I see how I could love you. I see how they might not. This could be so effortless. This could be so effortless.
That's a dope track, dope track. Just before we talk a little bit more about that, I just want to say hello to a few people in the chat. We've already said hi to Constance, Polly Ever After, Double P, and Benny Goggs as well. But yeah, everyone's feeling that one. And that's Just Good Beats is also a lathe cut label, isn't it? Because you put out, I think, about 30 of each copy, something like that.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah, 30 records each. Yeah.
And again, is there, well, it might, I don't know, it might be financial, but is there a reason why you're going for lathe cuts as opposed to trying to press, say, 300 sort of black vinyl?
Yeah, I just think it wouldn't work. Yeah, and it's a bit financial as well.
Yeah,
like the music is niche. Yeah, in my opinion. I don't really, like, I don't know, like, these kind of beats on 7, do they really sell huge numbers? Probably not. It's kind of like a way of testing the waters.
Yeah.
And then, like, part of me, like, I think, like, I kind of wanted to do the limited edition kind of route and keep it small and short. And the idea that, you know, when I was, you know, I was being a bit more consistent. I kind of slept a little bit over the last years, but these records were coming out every 2 months. And yeah. The idea was really that sort of, you know, it was 30 records that came out 2 months. Every 2 months, you could cut the next beat, be there, be square, grab it or miss it kind of thing. And yeah, I kind of wanted to keep it quite limited and short and sweet and move on to the next thing. Because when you're doing like big runs of 300, well, kind of, it starts becoming a sales job rather than a getting the music out there job. Yeah. And you're like looking, you know, your last 100 records, maybe thinking like, shit, who can I connect to and how can I sell it and da da da, and I need to get that so I can fund the next one. And, you know, it becomes a bit of a bitch, to be frank. Yeah. So, yeah, the idea was to try and keep it light and friendly and like desirable, like the kind of, you know, but, you know, it was financial as well, which is like, you know, it costs money to make these things. And it's a big commitment for 300 records. Like with these, like everything is like done by hand. So I mentioned like NMCP made the lathe by hand. Like the guys that supply them the plastic to make the records do that by hand. Every record gets played in real time. There is no speeding it up or copy and paste. Every record gets made in real time by hand. When we first started getting the sleeves, we did not know what the fuck we were doing. Excuse my French. But we didn't know what we were doing, and we were getting these flat. They were not made up like these, and we were having to stick the sleeves together. So that was like learning point number one, which is find carbon made sleeves up like this that were already made. But at that point, we were gluing the sleeves together, so that was a starting point. And then, you know, like, they're all hand pressed as well. So literally, what we kind of wanted to do, you know, like, it's a pic, you know, I view it as like a piece of art, really.
Yeah, just yeah.
The idea, which is every painting is unique, right? And this here is 100% unique because the way it was recorded means that it doesn't sound like every single one. You know, every stamp we've done is different, right? Well, different to some degree. So that's kind of, you're not just buying like the record and supporting the artist, but you're getting a like what I view as a lovely piece of art. Well, that's what I used to like. And I, you know, again, the idea of getting a dub plate to me was such a foreign concept, right? It's not familiar. You know, like to see someone pull a dub plate out of their bag, you're like, holy shit, like this guy is serious. You know, he's got tunes no one's even heard. You know, that was always a legendary thing to me. And that's kind of how I felt about these records when, you know, when we've been making them.
We've got Don Champ Sounds woken up. He's missed the maths.
Hit me up and I'll explain it.
He can watch it, but he can watch it back. But we can watch it. But Yeah, big up Don Champstad. A great inspirational show last week, and we're doing another one this week. I mean, we're getting proper nerdy. Which is good. You know, it's part of the scene. You know, we're talking about vinyl. We're talking about 45s. It's all part of the different areas and the different niches of our community. You know, it's brilliant. I love it. I think what you're saying is fantastic, and I think I'm nowhere near pressing anything myself yet. I've done some production in the past, but I think when I get there and I have a bit more time, I will be doing something very similar to you, getting lathe cuts 30. And like you say, you know, you just want to press something, get a few out there and see what happens. And you know, like you, me, you know, we don't have the time to sort of be trying to sell 300 copies of something and you know, and then be waiting for the next one. There's also another point, isn't there, because I think, unless anything's changed, getting the lathe cuts is probably a lot quicker than getting vinyl pressed at the moment. Is that still the case?
I'm not so well, for me it's not, because like I said, my friends are in Belarus, which has been messed up by the Ukraine war.
Yeah.
And then the thing is, I would probably hazard a guess at the, I mean, what I follow a lot of like the lathe cutters on Instagram. So you can like hashtag lathe cut records and you can follow all of that stuff. But I think that's just slammed because of the vinyl problems, actually. Like a lot of people, like I think if you've got a lathe, like it's hard not to be busy because people are desperately like trying to get stuff cut.
Yeah.
Because they don't want to wait for like the production times. Yeah, definitely.
Okay. All right. So that's one from your label. Where does the story take us next? Because I think your sort of selection was in a sort of story. What have you got next for us?
I mean, what I was going to do, I was going to kind of stick on the Just Good Beats theme, really. I guess, like, yeah, so we've been talking a lot about samples and turntablism and stuff like that. What I thought I'd kind of did, what I did was I pulled out a bunch of, like, samples. So yeah, I think like this kind of takes me up to present day a little bit. So if you listen to my streams, I do for like the coffee and donuts, or if you randomly hear me playing out, especially on the 45s these days, it's like I love collecting the samples, like whether it's like random stuff that I can sample, which I'll play you some stuff of, and or whether it's like samples from classic stuff. Because like I've got like all of it on like MP3 and, you know, stuff like that, and Ultimate Breaks and Beats and some comps, where like I think I played a set once where I took four comps out for not Ultimate Breaks and Beats, the other series, Beats and Breaks, that sounds crazy, but I think it's the other one. And I think I took four comps out with me and like played for 2 hours off them, and everything was heavyweight gold off it as well, which is kind of funny. But like, yeah, I just kind of love the idea of having the original 45s, and just being able to sample off that, and just like, you even like where I bought the wrong version of the 45 and suddenly you start looking at the versions, you're like, oh, that one's like 8 seconds longer, and you're like, oh shit, that's where the drum break was that I was looking for, and things like that. So, you know, there's little things you learn along the way which are really fun. And like, you know, like coming from that old hip-hop background of like cutting up the breaks and the turntablist side of like cutting up the breaks, like when I was, again, I throw myself back to when I was like 20 years old doing these nights in Liverpool, and like I convinced this guy, he's like, oh, you know, let me come down and like DJ for you. You can MC and I'll be DJing. He's like, yeah, you know, come down and spin some beats. And I took down like doubles of funk records and started like cutting up the breaks. And he turns to me, he's like, man, I didn't expect this. And he's like, this is fucking wicked. And to me, like, that's how I always view like hip hop. Like we used to go to like the Funking Pussy in Covent Garden, which was like a breaking jam. And they used to cut up the doubles and cut up the breaks and the breakers would break. And to me, that was like hip hop was, you know, cutting up the breaks. But I never, you know, I'd always done it in a cheapskate way, and having the time, patience and money, and just, yeah, the interest, I started going back and like digging the 45s. But anyway, the next one that I picked out is because I'm like massively, this kind of happened in reverse, really. So for Just Good Beats, I put out this beat by Loons.
Is this one? Yeah.
And one of the tunes on that is called Delphi. I think you might maybe have this one, Chris.
I think I have, yeah.
And then I was going through the records and I pulled out, I was digging, and I was out of the dig and I pulled out this record, which is the Delphonics, and it's Ready or Not.
That's a
classic, right? You know, well, I'll play it quickly. But, you know, that's a classic. That's a classic sample. It's got like a Missy Elliott sample at the beginning of a dun 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 dun, suck it to me. You know, that's like a Missy Elliott sample. Then it's also the Ready or Not, which the Fugees did.
So yeah.
But I have that record. That's a great dig, right? Samples, everything, like double whammy. And then I flipped it over and I was like, holy shit, this is the sample that Looms used for the Delpho record. So obviously Delphonics. And I should have really guessed that. Who Run It was by 3-6 Mafia. It was the first time I heard that sample. Yeah, exactly. It's like it's a classic. It's a real good one. Anyway, yeah. So this is. I'm sorry. Somebody loves you, girl. This I swear is true, girl. So you think no one cares? So yeah. So that was the sample, and I was like, oh man, I did not know that where Looms got the sample from.
Yeah,
but that was it. So I'll play you like the beat that he made using that.
Yeah, I do love this beat. I have got this. I do love it. Other side of it.
Let's play that back.
We're playing stuff. We're talking about speeding stuff up last week. Yeah, that's definitely one of my favorites from the from your label. I think we might have used that for the video or the photos from when we did the event in London a little while ago. Yeah. I think the post thing, I think I used that maybe even before, actually. But yeah, it's definitely one. I think that Double P's after a copy if you've got any spare. But you snooze, you lose, isn't it? I think is your label.
Yeah, it's kind of, you snooze, you lose records. If there's some on the website, you might be lucky. I mean, have a look on Discogs. Maybe someone's reselling one. I don't know. That'd be a sad state of affairs, but yeah, maybe.
Exactly. Right. I saw you putting something that didn't look like a 7 on the record deck, but
yeah,
it doesn't matter. We're cool on this show. We're not complete purists. We had digital stuff last week from Don Champ Sound and NPC stuff. So what is that? That looks like
I mean, I thought I'd be a bit cheeky and start plugging myself. So I've been talking about scratchy stuff and all of that, but I do make beats myself. Although I don't really hump them around as much as I should do.
One of your beats, definitely.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to play you. So I got this dub plate cut. So during lockdown, I wasn't working again for a little bit of time. And I was like, awesome. I'm locked in my house with all my toys, and a bunch of sevens that I haven't had a chance to sample yet. So I'm going to just get busy. So I started I started making tunes. I just like got into making shitloads of tunes. And I wanted to do like hip hoppy boom bap stuff, because that's how I was feeling at the time. And then I just got some stuff cut onto like a little 10-inch lathe cut just for fun, because I was like, you know, it'd be nice to actually have something of mine to play out, because I don't really have, I've got one other thing. I mean, apart from the scratch records, I've got one other musical piece that is on wax. That was like a drum and bass tune that I did for the Dub Studio fundraiser. Because, you know, I feel like writing drum and bass, and I still do bits of that. So, yeah, I thought what I would do is play you one of the records that I've sampled, and then I can play you, like, the tune. And then, funny enough, like, this has a kind of a story behind it. So this is the song I sampled. You'll find this in so many, like, pound bins, Average White Band. And I use For Your Love. It's the first one. And so my friend Simon Hargreaves, over lockdown, what he decided to do was to pimp his YouTube video, YouTube channel. I have no idea what it's called, but you can like, it's like Cy Hargreaves Film Video Productions or something crazy official. And he was asking us, like, trying to generate some scratchy content. He's got great scratchy content if you want to learn about history of scratchy stuff, all of that, Cy Hargreaves video. And he's like, he wants to make some content. And I think, Criztoz, I think I sent you the video before. But basically, we made this little video with me making a beat. And if anyone's tried to do this before, I think Dom Champ Sound maybe mentioned something about this in his last one. With, like, the idea of making a beat on camera is, like, terrifying, because sometimes it can be awesome, but like 9 out of 10 times it's not. And so you've made some poor person like watch you make a flop. So it just so happened that this was a huge, like, in my opinion, this was a bit of a success, where we picked the right sample. Like, we made a cool beat, we made a cool video out of it. And then a friend of mine that I knew from like some hip hop jams back in the day, like, saw the video. He's like, oh man, you can't just leave that beat without like someone rapping over it. Like, you know, we've got to put something over this as well. So my homie Mike Midas was like, come on, finish the song. Send me the beats, let's finish the song. So he like laid down some raps, and then I laid down some cuts over the top of it, and we ended up finishing it off properly. So this was kind of like ended up being hugely productive output for just like one record that costs a pound from like my local like shitty shop. So I'll play you the sample, and I'll play you the beat.
I've dropped the link to the video in the chat if anyone wants to catch that later.
And then we got even more value for this one, because one last plug, which was during lockdown, there was COVID stuff popping off as well, but we got like if you know Constance and you saw her Back to Mine, she's from Chicago. And during that time, like, Black Lives Matter was popping off as well, and we wanted to do something to support. And I have been doing something every year since on the anniversary of the George Floyd incident. Puppies aren't for Christmas, they're for life, right? And I think if you pick a cause that you should like run with that shit, not just a bit who's popular. So we have been releasing a free to download EP where you can donate what you like. So the other nice thing about this is if you you can't get this on wax, but you can download it for free, or you can make a donation and that money goes to charity. So you can find that on our Bandcamp, and there's two albums that we've done. So you can cop that for free, or you can make a donation. And this tune, the tune that I made, is on it. The first EP is all mine. That's all my beats from my personal stash. Like I said, I'm very shy, I don't put them out, so that was a big jump for me, but I wanted to do something. And then the second EP, everyone from the label chipped in. So let's play some music, funky.
Don Champ at 33.
Yeah. That's great. I'm not going to subject you to the rest of that song. But yeah. Like, if you've got the digging ear, you kind of hear that, and you're like, okay, I can do something with that. That's quite a nice loop. So let's play you what we came up with in the end.
I'm likely to get lively over a hype beat. Rightly, I get hypey. Come and try me. Ready for evocative rhymes and pocket. Now you've heard a zillion provocative lines. Let's rock it. Thrill of the chase. Up the lung, about to fill up the bass. In your motherfucking face. Time's come. To spark the M to the IC. I'm a shooting star in this Milky Way galaxy. Life on Earth is one big test. Jury stays out though, it's one big mess. Pokey styles play out in more ways than one. I need that change to come. Got to levitate, accelerate, attenuate. Till the motherfucking levee breaks at any rate. Locating angles while others finagle. Close to love each other, but the world is a jungle. I need new angles.
That's a dope beat, mate. That's really cool.
Yeah, cheers,
man. I like that.
Thanks, Gavin. Thanks. That's, yeah, no, it's awesome.
It's not, yeah. I mean, it's quite vulnerable, isn't it? Putting your stuff out there. And also, obviously, you know, playing it in a DJ set is one thing, but obviously, you know, playing it on something like this, something that means a lot to you. And you know, these things take a lot of time, I imagine. You know, beats. You know, what, as we're talking about beats, you know, what is your sort of process? Obviously, you've showed us what you sampled. What would you have used to sort of sample that into? We were talking about MPCs and doors and stuff like that last time. But, you know, what do you use? What's your production setup?
It's funny because I still stick to the computer an awful lot. I think I started with it and then I branched out into hardware. And then because of time constraints, more than anything, I like using, like, the computer quite a lot. I mean, that tune, I would have sampled straight into the computer. It's really interesting, actually, because using the computer makes you do things in a different way that is different from the pads in a very different way. Because, So I would have sampled that into the computer, but then because I'm sampling into the computer, I can take quite large chunks. Whereas when you're sampling into the MPC, I've got like an MPC 1000 and a 500. You think more loop based, and then you're thinking chunks of loops. But the thing is, when you've got it all laid out on the computer, what I like to do is I chop it all up into like chunks, like you would do on an MPC, like a 16 step kind of thing, or an 8 step,
even
chops. And then I just mash it all up. And the thing is, with the MPC, you might have to spread that, might be spread over like bank A, bank B, and bank C, and so it's not actually easy to jump from A to C. Like you got to kind of have that idea and put those things on the pads, sort of in the 16 late layout. So I find actually with the computer, it's kind of an interesting thing, which suddenly you start joining things. And there's like a kind of funny beat makers thing that people do where it's like, can you remove the vocals from a vocal track? And actually by taking, like, you'll suddenly notice there's breathing gaps in between songs, in between, like, where they're singing, sorry. Where you can take those tiny snippets, and if you take all of those and put them back together, you'll actually get like an instrumental loop from it. If you can really be asked and dig, edit that hard. So yeah, like, you know, there's different ways of doing it, but yeah, for that particular beat, I sampled into the computer. We were doing it all on video, so you can go on YouTube and you can check the video and watch the highlights. We sampled into the computer. The break comes from like another record that I'd sampled before. And then I've got like a load of drum kits that I like whacking through Native Instruments Kontakt. And then flick that onto SP12 mode, run everything through tons of saturation, and bit crush it. And yeah, you can kind of get it sounding a bit S9. I mean, that's kind of like my goal, is to make it sound a bit like an S950 or an SP12.
Right.
Kind of. like make it a little bit grainier, because otherwise it doesn't quite feel right. It's a bit too polished if you're doing it all through the computer.
S950 is the Yakai, isn't it? The sort of with the floppy disk still.
You might see I've got in this corner here, this is like an S5000, so it's like the without the pads is the S series.
Because
the 950 is just legendary because that's what all the producers use.
Yeah, because Evil Ed still produces a lot of stuff on his. I think he's more recently got an MPC Live, but he sort of swears by it because it's just what he learned how to use, you know. And obviously, once you get into a rhythm and a technique and you've got your own style of how you make beats, it's quite difficult to sort of jump to something else. But also, that's your signature sound, isn't it? That, you know, people get the sound, and if they hear beats, like if you hear a lot of Evil Ed's beats, you know, you can tell it's one of his beats just from the sort of the sound and what he's used, you know. So cool. Okay, what have you got lined up next? Another beat of yours or another sampled?
Yeah, I mean, like, I was gonna do like another sample maybe.
Do it definitely.
So this was like, yeah, this is just like the next tune that I put on the record. But this is funny because I guess like this is one of my favorite tunes, and really this was meant to start off as a homage to like the rap tune that sampled it. And you always hear me play this like probably my 45 set. So the tune is Playing Your Game by Barry White.
Yeah.
Is mega popular because I think that's had an edit.
Jim Sharp's done an edit. Yeah.
It's Jim's edit. And it's funny because like I was telling Jim, like when I hear the tune and it's not the edit, it kind of confuses me now because I love the edit so much that he made.
Yeah. I play it quite a lot. It's great.
Yeah, it's really good. It's really catchy how he's arranged it. I was kind of doing like the I wanted to like just recreate the hip hop tune, and I was just like, oh, can I squeeze something else different out of this? Because you know, just recreating the hip hop tune is so easy, right? It's just the loop. And I was like, how can I take this sample and flip it in a different way? And it's funny, I've played the beats of people before that I made and said, like, can you recognize the sample? And they're just like, no, I cannot. So it was mission achieved in my opinion, but I think it, like, the effect came out nice. So let's play, this is the original. I've got this in the right place.
That's a beautiful beat. That's really cool. I think having heard it and obviously telling us what it is and then hearing it, you can hear it. But if you hadn't heard it sort of immediately before, you would be going, wow, what, you know, what is this? But yeah, brilliant, really good. Really good. You're blushing now. It's all right. But yeah, no, it's but that's what it's about. It's putting stuff out there, and it's the same with DJing and Twitch and all the rest of it. You put yourself out there, you just don't know what's going to come back. And you know, it's nice when people do give you sort of comments and you know, tell you things are good. But that's great. Right, I think you also said that you might have something on the MPC that you might want to play us. Is that set up, ready to play us? Your mic's gone. I can't hear you. Can you hear me?
Oh shit, that was my bad.
That's all right. Right. Let's get back to it.
I think I'd thrash your eardrums if I played the stuff off the MPC, because okay. None of it's like mastered. I was like playing it through earlier, and none of it's mastered, and it sounds
okay. No, fair enough.
Like something, like I said, I've always had this weird influence of like, I love the hip hop and I love ravey stuff as well. Yeah. And the stuff that's on the MPC. Funny enough, I started getting into like Chicago footwork. Like I watched what's it called? Tim and Barry's Don't Watch This, right. Which is a documentary about the Chicago footwork scene. And then that was probably 2014 when that came out. And then I went to Chicago in 2015 and I saw footwork and it blew my mind. And if you remember, like the story started of me being into dancing and breaking, right?
Yeah.
And so when I like videos of footwork started popping up on YouTube, and I just saw like this and I was like, holy shit, like what is this? Like I thought, like, you know, like I love like something fresh and like edgy and things like that, like you know, like a new perspective or a new way of looking at things. And when I saw like the way how like the footwork, like the guys were footworking, if you've ever seen footwork dancing, like Google it or YouTube it, it's really, really interesting how they get down, and it's just hardcore. And like they do dance battles and they go like often against each other, and it's like kind of aggressive, but it's all in time, and it's, yeah, I loved it. And I was just blown away by it. And I was blown away by the music, because it's mad bass heavy. And like at the time I was like listening to like dubstep, you know, like bits of dubstep in the background of stuff. And that was all about the drop, right? And the crazy thing about footwork is it has no drop. It's not a formulaic music that's like that. And so like you're listening to the tune going like, oh, it's like it's going, it's like, where is the drop? You're like, there is no drop, this is the tune. Like it's fucking like hypnotic, and it's like making you want to stomp your feet and dance and like brock. So yeah, I love the stuff. So like a lot of like the production I still do, like, I mean, I stuck up on my Instagram stories like at the weekend. I was like making like nasty dubsteppy footwork at the weekend, because like that's stuff that I like making as well. So it's not just like, you know, like I find it really fun to scratch over. Like there's two like kind of schools of scratching, and there's like, yeah, like the laid back hip hoppy stuff, but you know, like, you know, I'm scratch lord as well as the rest of the guys, and like I like getting down over hard stuff too. When it comes to scratching, like I think it puts like it wrong steps people when you start like scratching over hard music. They're like, oh, I didn't realize, you know, I thought it was just like the, you know, the chorus.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, it's like scratching over drum and bass or something like that, you know, is always, yeah. Is always fun, you know. I quite like, and also because the tempo is a bit higher, it's you know, there's a little bit more stuff you can do. Right.
So I would play you something off the MPC, but I don't know if people would really get down with that. But what I did want to play you was...
Yeah, yeah. What have you got?
I promised you... So I think this... I don't know if I've done at least seven, I'm guessing. But...
don't worry about the numbers,
yeah. This was something like... But, so we went, like, me and Constance... So I met Constance through, in a way, through Cut and Paste Records and traveling around the States. And we met in Chicago. And like our crazy love story is that we loved digging records together. That was like our first date, was digging records in Amsterdam and having coffee and donuts. And yeah, we love
coffee digging. In Amsterdam.
Yeah, coffee and a donut. Yeah. like that's how I get down every morning, every Saturday is coffee and donuts time, right? So anyways, we hit it off because and we got married and we're having a baby. One of the things we love doing is traveling and digging. Our vacations kind of revolve around like, and what the record shop's like there too. and if it doesn't kind of tick that box, then it's like there's other places we'd like to hit up, right?
So hold on. You specifically choose your holiday destination as to whether there's good record shops there or not.
I mean, it's not good, but just like, is there a record shop there?
Is there a record shop? Yeah.
Is there a record shop?
That's a good choice of, that's a good way of choosing a destination. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we love,
both of you are into it, so it works. It works.
Yeah. I've always been a city person myself, right? So my adventures always used to take me to like other cities wherever I'm going. And Constance is a beach person because it's like she used to want to escape the city, right? And she loves the sea and all of that. It's good for the soul. So our compromise is there a record shop? And then like if there's a city or a beach there, who cares kind of thing. So that works quite nicely. Like our honeymoon, we went to Japan because like we wanted to go digging in Japan because we just heard it was so legendary. So like where maybe I feel like where maybe people go shopping or get dragged around the shops or whatever for their interest. Like that's how like maybe we crush a day in a city is like hauling ass across town to find as many record shops as we possibly can. And like one of our days of sightseeing, that's like how we end up seeing like a lot of stuff of the city and seeing like the real things of the city. And like Japan,
it's also chatting to people in the record shops, not just the people who are serving. I was in Rarekind today and I got chatting to a guy called John the Baptist, who's a DJ and he's on radio shows and all stuff. And then we just suddenly connected and we're going to message each other and do something at some point. But it's part of getting to know the locals, isn't it? All the local scene, and finding out what's going on tonight. Oh, there's this hip hop show or there's this, reggae thing over there or there's something going on, and that's part of traveling, isn't it?
Japan was exactly like that, and everyone there was all like, it literally started from one person being really like the first record shop we went into in Osaka with a person being ultra friendly and like helping us get from A to B, and then us getting to that the next place saying such and such from this record shop so told us we should come here, and then being like, oh my god, you've got to do this and you've got to do that, and that kind of and then we ended up spending my birthday in like this amazing vinyl bar. The guy's dropping hip hop. And like, as we're sort of just warming up, two random Japanese b-boys walk in and they're just like, they're loving the vibe. And we just had like, I think there's like 12 of us, like four of us that turned up there and the rest of this tiny little bar all vibing and getting absolutely smashed. And it was just all around this like love of music and hip hop. And because we've been sent by person A to person B that sent us to this place.
Well, you wouldn't have found that place otherwise.
No, 100%. No, no way at all. No way at all. Yeah. So, yeah, that will... Anyway, so we love traveling. We love going record shopping. And, like, the last place that we went traveling was Italy, like, about 3 weeks ago or 4 weeks ago. And I think Constance did her coffee and donut show... not last weekend, but the weekend before, and she played like all the stuff that she picked up on 7. And I was determined to play part 2 of my 45s mix, so I played all the hip-hop I didn't get to play the 45 day mix. But Constance was nagging me, he's like, you should have played Criztoz, this record that you picked up in Italy. So I thought in tribute all back to mine, if you're coming back to my yard, this is the record that I would have played you. So it's a cover.
I like covers, as you know.
And it's by no one I'd ever heard of before, Byron Lee of the Dragonairs. Yes. You know this one, Criztoz?
It's the Live and Let Die.
There's a cover of Live and Let Die, but there's a reggae cover of Sol Makosa.
I've got Live and Let Die. I'm going to be honest. I haven't looked what's on the B-side, but I don't think...
Oh, man!
I don't think it's Reggae Makosa. I think it's something else.
Oh, okay, that's weird. All right,
I will check later, and then I'll let you know in the chat tomorrow or something.
This is a really cool cover because I love the original. Is it Manu Digbell, the Sol Mikoza original tune? And yeah, this was, we just heard this and we just like, oh shit, like, you know, gotta grab that.
Wow. Yeah.
Constance did pick this one. Just trying to have a dig to see if I can find my one. I've got a feeling it might be on a Dynamite 100% Dynamite reissue, so I don't think it's going to have that on the other side. I can't remember what's on the other side, but I'll dig it out and find it. But I love Sol Mikoza. I've got various versions of it and a reggae Mikoza. That's dope. I don't think you can top that. I'm in heaven with that record. I thought that like ticked every box for you. The reggae version.
Pretty much reggae cover, Sol Mikoza, the Seven. I mean, yeah, I'm not sure it can get much better than that.
And I mean, this is saying also made in Italy on it as well. So, but like, Constance in the chat, I picked this out. Like, I'm going to set the stories. I picked this out first and I put it away because it was mad expensive. And you picked it out second and you were like, I don't care how much it costs. So, like, that's actually how it works. Like, I'm actually the sensible one when it comes to the spending. But
well, at the end of the day, you get two for one because you both get to appreciate it. You know, that's a good thing in your household, in one sense.
Maybe.
That's why I said, I was talking to Zizi about this the other day, and I can't remember what she said. She said, well, yeah, I'm just going to take all your records when I'm a little bit older. I was like, okay, I might have to start locking my room. Yes, I'm not going to have any records. Right, let me just look for someone to raid. I think we're pretty much there. It's been a brilliant show, but let me just see. I think I know who we're going to raid, but I'm just going to see if he's still live. Oh no! I think
I was going to say massive thanks to everyone in the chat. I was going to say big thanks.
Yeah. Tell us what you've got coming up while I find someone to raid, because I was going to raid Evil Ed, but it looks like he's gone off.
Waxworks, pick up yourself, mate. Loving the handy Waxworks. I'm going to get one of your boxes. Just don't tell my wife because it's her birthday present.
It's a bit late for that now. She's watching the show.
I'm just kidding. she'd just be like, "Why have you got a package? What is this?"
So what have you got coming up? Tell me what you got coming up, and then I'll get the raid going. And yes, Polly, sorry. Yes, it is recorded. It will be on YouTube tomorrow, as is all the mixes. And if you just want to listen, it will be on Mixcloud. So yeah, but we'll share the links around tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, while I'm here, I'm going to plug the next Super Scratch Sunday. So we didn't get to talk about it, but one of the jams I do is a jam for Super Scratch Sunday. We're going to be in Croydon in July at the VR Bar. You can follow me on Kut Class and at Kut Class on Instagram,
or you can find me by my stage name, Adam Bell, on Facebook. And yeah, that's where I'll be sticking up flyers. And you can also find us in the Facebook group, Super Scratch Sunday, and on the Instagram as well. And yeah, if you're London based and you like scratchy business and you want to meet up with other turntablists and you need a friend to scratch with, then come and join us for our open deck sessions. And we're going to be BR Bar in Croydon, July, like 20 something or other. But yeah, I'll be posting flyers for all of that.
Great.
And yeah, hopefully me and Criztoz can really our homies into the next into finding a venue for the next
we'll do that again soon. Obviously, you know, you might be a little bit busy in the next few months, but we'll definitely do that soon. And I will actually come to your house at some point. I know we were meant to do it before that, but obviously events and going to Great Yarmouth conspired against us. But anyway, I've just got to plug something very quickly before we raid out, because tomorrow night, if I can get it up here, let me have a look. Maybe I can get it from here. Tomorrow night, we start a new show called The Pitch Rider's Guide to Glastonbury 2022, because me and Sam Tweaks are going to Glastonbury. And so we're going to do a couple of shows before that. So the first one's tomorrow night, 8 o'clock on my channel. And then Sam's doing a couple of hours, and then we'll be chatting again on my channel on the 8th of June and on the 15th. So we're just talking about Glastonbury, how excited we are, and picking out tunes. Tomorrow's theme is daytime set. So we're just picking out between us sevens that we would play in a daytime set. So hopefully you can join us tomorrow. But otherwise, thank you everyone for tuning in. Thank you, Kut Class, Adam. Been brilliant and an inspiration, education. Fantastic. Take it easy, guys.
Thanks for having us.